Listening Library presents The Sinister Booksellers of Bath by Garth Nix. Read for you by Marisa Calin.
Prologue. Bath, Winter Solstice, 1977. The young man running panicked in the dark, instinctively headed towards the abbey. The streetlights had snapped out a minute before, and he had been suddenly attacked. Something immensely strong had grabbed him in the darkness, lifting him from the bandstand where he'd been slumped trying to work out how drunk he was and what to do, since Wednesday night was about to become Thursday morning, and everywhere he could get another drink was either closed or wouldn't let him in. He'd only escaped because he was wearing his coat like a cloak, his arms not in it, and whatever grabbed him had been momentarily confused as he slithered out of the £2 Oxfam woolly bargain like a lizard leaving its sacrificial tail in a predator's mouth. He took the steps up and out of the park without slowing and vaulted the locked gates at the top without pause, heading towards the abbey because he knew with absolute conviction that whatever was after him was not human. And though he had never thought of himself as religious before and had stopped going to church with his mum when he was 12, he had experienced a sudden resurgence of faith. The abbey seemed the only place that might offer him shelter from whatever it was that came so swiftly after him now. So swiftly, and without normal footfalls. Instead, it made sharp, scraping sounds, all too like a butcher's knife being rapidly sharpened on a steel. The three-quarter moon provided what little light there was, limning the dark shadow of the abbey ahead with lines of silver. The paving stones were rimmed with frost and slippery underfoot, and he almost fell as he reached the massive corner of the medieval edifice and raced around it and along the southern side. He was now astonishingly sober and incredibly frightened. "Help!" he screams into the darkness. "Help! Someone help me!" It was typical there was no one around to help. Two Rozzers had stopped their patrol car to look down at him from Pierpont Street an hour ago, but they hadn't bothered getting out of their nice warm vehicle and into the cold and drizzle. They'd looked because he was a punk with an orange mohawk and a safety pin through his nose, and a once good black overcoat splattered with runny drawings in white house paint, which he thought were anarchist symbols, but meant something else entirely. But he was by himself, and a weedy, drunken punk slumped on the bandstand in Parade Gardens wasn't a bother to anyone. He'd been glad they'd left him alone. He never wanted any attention from the police. But where were they now? In his heart, he knew the police wouldn't be any help anyway. But he shouted again, not slowing his headlong rush along the side of the abbey. He had a vague memory the main entrance was right up the other end, and the doors were probably closed anyway. But if he could get there, surely a church would be safe. Maybe even the front steps would work. But the thing chasing him was too close. That horrible scraping sound was louder and louder. The cold hand gripped him and yanked him back, a hand colder than the winter air. This time, he was taken by the neck, not by clothing he could shuck. He tried to free himself, reaching back to break the thing's grip, and thrashed his body with all his strength. But it was not enough, far from enough. He couldn't escape, and he couldn't breathe. He kicked back at the thing's legs, pain blossoming in his heels. It felt like he'd kicked the stone walls of the abbey, rather than the creature that held him. But he knew he hadn't. The grip on his throat eased a little, and he managed to get in a gasp of air. His attacker dragged him away from the abbey, lifting him as if he were no more than a stick of wood, and took him across the abbey churchyard. With every step, there came that horrible scraping sound. Shk, 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 shk. They came out of the shadow of the abbey into the moonlight. The punk twisted his head around enough to see his captor, and wished he hadn't. He was held by the neck in an unbreakable grip, by something that had the general outward appearance of a woman. One who stood 7 feet tall, and whose skin was grey and smooth, but weirdly mottled, as if thousands of tiny fossilized shells had been merged together and made into dark marble. Living stone, if that was possible. Her fierce, colourless eyes moved, and her mouth twitched, apparently in irritation. She was clad in a simple cross-hatched pattern dress with a high waist and puffed sleeves, all also of impossibly flexible moving stone. She had no feet. Her legs ended in broken stumps at the ankle, jagged breaks. And that was why she made the horrible sharpening noise as she moved, stone upon stone. The grey stone woman stopped in the full light of the moon and shook out the folded paper she held in her right hand. An old, time-yellowed paper or parchment, the only thing about it that was not stone. It was a map of some kind. For a moment, he hoped she might let go of him in order to unfold it properly. But she didn't. She shook the map once, twice, then held it up so the moonlight fell on it, and it began to glow with its own radiance. As she did so, the punk caught a metallic, sulphurous whiff. For a moment, he thought it somehow came from the illuminated map. Then he heard water gushing and saw wafts of steam rising from the narrow gaps between the paving stones. The stone woman opened her mouth and emitted a growl, the first even faintly human noise she'd made. "You trespass on my domain," said another woman, one the punk couldn't see. There was a lot of steam around now, and the iron stench was strong. Hot water rose up between the flagstones, water stained an orange red, a sudden flood that streamed around the marble woman's sharp stumps. Everything became cloaked in steam, and the punk blinked and grimaced, trying to see. But there was only more strangeness, a figure appearing with a face of beaten gold upon a vaguely defined body woven of steam and rusty water. The golden face was curiously familiar. He had seen it somewhere before. "I have taken my prey, and now I will depart," said the stone woman. Her voice was very strange, echoing and distant, as if it came from a hole beneath the ground. "I did not give you leave to hunt here. You were warned and punished when last you trespassed on my domain," said the golden face. Her hair was plaited into a kind of crown, and unlike the marble statue, the golden mouth did not move when she spoke, as if it were only a mask for the watery creature behind it. "Besides, he is mine." The marble statue did not answer.
"I am?" asked the punk.
"Traverselli," said the steam-wreathed apparition. "Your mother gave you sixpence to throw in my waters when you came to worship me on your 7th birthday."
I did," squeaked Travis.
The only waters he could remember throwing any kind of money into was on a trip to the Roman baths just nearby. It came back to him that his mother had given him a sixpence. He had wanted to keep it for lollies, but she made him throw it in. A real silver sixpence. It had been a few years before the change to decimal currency and the dull 5p coins. They'd had afternoon tea in the pump room afterward. He hadn't thought of it as worshipping anyone, but he suddenly remembered where he'd seen the golden face before. It was a mask on display in the museum part of the Roman baths. The stone woman suddenly swung Travis towards the map, throwing him at it as if it were a window. As she let go, he felt a moment of elation that he would escape after all, until he found himself falling not to the pavement, but onto grass, somewhere entirely different. It was suddenly bright, so bright he had to shut his eyes for a second. Blinking them open, he saw he was somewhere outdoors, but surrounded by high walls. It was hot, savagely hot, after the cold winter's night he'd been in a moment before. He started to get up, but was forced down again as the stone woman suddenly appeared in front of him. She was hissing in anger. The map she still clutched in her right hand was somehow stretched into thin air, as if held by some invisible person opposite her. And as he watched, it tore across the folds, and one entire quarter of the map disappeared, rusty water spraying down the statue's arm. She turned to him, her hand making a terrible claw.
She picked him up, stone fingernails ripping through skin, deep to the bone, and shook him like a terrier with a rat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.